Hello, my name is Nitya Narasimhan, and I'm a senior cloud advocate at Microsoft. Today, I want to talk to you about JavaScript objects. In fact, I have just six things to tell you. Let's get started. First, what are objects? You encounter a lot of objects in the real world. You have books that are in libraries. You have songs that live in playlists. Each one of these has two different things that make them useful to us. First, they have attributes, data that describe them. So a book has a title, an author, and maybe if it's in a library, it has a status that tells you whether it's available or not. Similarly, they have actions you can take on them. So you can check in or check out a book from the library. JavaScript objects are a way for you to represent these real-world objects in code. So rather than attributes, we refer to them as JavaScript object properties. Properties are effectively those attributes that describe that object. So in this case, in green, this particular object called book has three properties. It has a title, an author, and a flag, a status flag, that tells you if it's available. Objects also have methods, similar to the actions we talked about. In this case, in red, you see that this object has two methods, check-in and check-out, which effectively manipulate the value associated with the availability status. The one thing you can take away from objects looking at this definition is that properties are simply variables associated with the object, and methods are simply functions associated with that object. Next, let's think about the object syntax and its creation. In the example I've been using so far, this form where we've kind of created an object by simply using the curly braces and enclosing a series of name value pairs separated by commas, that particular form is known as an object literal because you're creating and defining it at the same time in the same statement. But what exactly is an object? An object is nothing more than an unordered collection of name value pairs. In this case, those name value pairs consist of the properties of the object as well as the methods. Properties in green, when you saw them before, and methods in red. The object literal, what you see here, is the easiest way for you to create an object. Simply open curly braces, list out all the properties and methods of your object, close curly braces, and you've declared yourself a new object. The other way you can create objects is by using what's called constructors and the new keyword. An object constructor is, you can think of it almost as a template or a blueprint for an object. It tells you what that should look like, but that's just a definition. In order for you to actually create an instance of that template, you use the keyword new, which effectively stamps out one example and fills it with data. So in this particular case, we're using the base template called hello object, and you can create yourself an instance of any object by basically saying, in this case, book equals new object. Now you've stamped yourself an instance of that vanilla object, and you can now associate it with your custom properties and methods, exactly as shown in the example here. One thing you need to take away from this is we've had two different ways for you to create objects, but once created, they're going to behave exactly the same. So pick your path. When starting out, you might find literals very easy to use, but as you skill up, constructors have a lot of great properties that are going to make it easier for you to do things like inheritance. We're not going to cover things like function constructors and prototypes in this particular module, but if you're curious, go check those out. Great, so we've created this object, but chances are you want to use those properties or invoke those methods, right? How do you do that? Let's start first by talking about properties. Properties are basically the attributes of the object, if you will. They have immutable names and mutable values. What that means is once you've assigned properties to an object, you can change the name. You can remove the property, but you can't go and alter the existing property name. However, you can alter its values. And you can do that using one of two different notations. You can access and modify them. To access a property, approach number one is to use what's called the dot notation. If you're familiar with namespaces, this format is actually likely familiar to you. It's object.propertyName. So in this particular case, if I say book.title, I'm effectively going to get back the value associated with that property, which is 1984. I can also say book.title equals and give it a new value if I want to, which will effectively change the title of that book. The second notation, which sometimes is harder for people to wrap their heads around, is known as the bracket notation. And it's easier to remember if you think of the fact that properties are effectively like hash maps. They're a key and a value. So with the bracket notation, using object name, brackets, property name as the key, which in turn will go and fetch back the value. So in this case, I can say book, square brackets, title, and note that the title is in quotes, will now return to you 1984. Make sense? Hopefully. Remember, we also talked about methods. Methods are simply special properties whose type happens to be that of functions. In other words, a method is simply a function definition associated with that object. If you look at the two examples here in red, check-in and check-out, because methods are special properties, you can access the method definition exactly the same way, using either the dot notation or the bracket notation. So book.checkin will return you the function object. Book square brackets checkin will also return you the function object associated with the definition of checkin. That's about getting access to the function definition or object itself. What if you want to use it? Well, you invoke it just like any other function using regular standard parentheses. So in this case, book.checkin, open brackets, close brackets, will actually execute the code inside that function, setting the isAvailable property to true. And note that I can use either one of those notations. So I can actually use the bracket notation as well. Simply use the same way to access the property, access the function or method, and then call brackets on it to invoke it. Sound easy? I hope so. Last but not least, this is actually one of the most complex, at the same time, most powerful concepts that you learn. If you remember looking at those method definitions, you might have seen an interesting keyword called this. So I've replicated part of that function definition here and changed it slightly so we can talk about it. So checkin, in the function checkin, I don't say isAvailable equals true. I say this.isAvailable equals true. What is this? This is really a keyword that sets the runtime context for the function. It's a way for the function to be able to get access to other data or functions in its runtime scope. So when we're thinking of methods, which are functions associated with an object, a method might want to look at other peer property values. If you think of standalone functions, a standalone function might want to prefer some global context data that's available in that runtime. The this keyword lets you do that. The interesting thing is this is bound to a different object at runtime based on context. So if you are using a method, this by default is bound to the object that represents the owner of that method. So in this case, if I use this, it'll return book. But if I'm looking at a standalone function, it maps towards something called the global object. It's an object that represents the global runtime. We'll talk about that in just a second. There are some caveats though. If you apply strict mode, then unless you've explicitly set the value of this, it'll turn out to be undefined. And more importantly, we're not going to cover it in this module, but there are ways for you to actually specifically or explicitly tell a function what this object is by using methods or by using functions like apply. Look those up if you're interested. But I'm going to stop with kind of like just one final thing about the global object. Remember I told you that if you're a standalone function, that this will refer to a global object? Well, it turns out that if you're using JavaScript in the browser, that global object is the window. But if you're using it in Node, it references an object literally called global that represents the global runtime. And it allows you to associate properties or methods with that global object and have them be accessed by other functions in that scope. Because you know, the global object refers to different things, whether you're in the browser or in Node, there is actually a convenience, a keyword called globalThis that you can use in your code that automatically maps to the right global object without having you have to change your code. Hope that was useful. With that, that was our super fast introduction to JavaScript objects. Six things that you hopefully learned. What are objects? What is the syntax of an object? How do you create them, either as literals or from constructors? What are properties and how do you access them? What are methods and how do you invoke them? And finally, what is this? Hope you had fun. See you at the next module.